Welcome. Sitting here with a couple of members of L.A. Guns here. Hey, Philip and Tracii, how are you doing?
That's us.
Welcome out to the right coast, as they say here.
Right coast. Well, it depends where you're standing.
Yeah.
It does.
What direction you're standing.
Right. But we're supposing if you're looking in Costa Rica, you know, looking north.
Okay.
All right.
On the right.
Anyway, so you guys are like a piece of the L.A. scene. I mean, you're like the epitome of what goes on in L.A.
We are the epitome. Mm-hmm.
You are the epitome. Like, one of your members is in W.A.S.P. and your bass player was in Faster Pussycat.
That's
and
right.
There's some connection with you and L.A. and the Guns N' Roses.
Yeah.
And
well, there is a connection with me and L.A. Guns, too.
I bet there is. And we'll go into that later.
Yeah, but, you want to hear about the Guns N' Roses?
Tell us about the Guns N' Roses.
Okay, I'll tell you about
you
the Guns N' Roses.
Had to tell it before, but tell us now.
It's okay. Originally, Axl Rose, who sings for Guns N' Roses now, me and him started L.A. Guns together. Okay.
And it was cool, and things were going fine.
Yeah, and it was very nice. And then we got some of the other guys from his old band, Hollywood Rose, involved. And then we called it Guns N' Roses instead of L.A. Guns. And then I wanted to do more of my material. He wanted to do more of his material that he was writing with the rhythm guitar player, Izzy. And that was great. But, you know, we just decided, you know, maybe we'd be better off giving the world 23 songs instead of 10 songs this year or something, you know.
Creative differences, is that the term that they use?
Yeah, something like that.
They hate each other. Actually, I'm being honest.
For about 10 minutes, yeah, we were kind of like, but everything's fine now, you know, and we're both doing,
you know. Each other's birthday party thing still?
I haven't had a birthday party in a long time.
I'm Phil Lewis from LA Guns, and this is Sex Action.
With Philip and Tracii of LA Guns. Sorry, I called him Phil, and I stepped on his feelings a bit. Your first album out, if we could just take a look at that. You credit a bunch of people like Stephen Piercy and Tame It Down and Rosanna Arquette and Joni Mitchell and Ringo Starr. What's up?
I gotta tell you, almost every one of those is the guy who played drums on the album who's not in the band anymore. But he's still family, so.
So that's
nice
great.
People.
So you still
like, nice.
Hang with Joni Mitchell and Ringo Starr? I mean, they're nice people, I suppose.
Yeah, why not?
Well, like Nickey, our old drummer, and Ringo Starr have a lot in common. They look the same.
He's not sarcastic. About the same age, too.
Yeah. But he's not in the band anymore.
That's right.
So we'll just gingerly drop it aside. So if people went and saw you playing in clubs as you're doing this big tour,
right.
They won't see him at all.
No.
So
no.
How is that going?
Great.
Oh, man, we've been selling out every night. It's been a lot more successful than we thought. The album's doing a lot better than we thought it would be. So.
Oh, you thought it was going to be a million seller, right?
No, we were happy if it sold like 30 or 50,000, you know, yeah. First album, local LA band, you know, and all of a sudden it's like, bang, here we are, like up in the high part of the charts. It's
and we're on the right coast.
And you're on the right coast. So you've been selling them out in like New Brunswick?
Texas.
Texas?
We're working our way around through Atlanta and up the East Coast, the right coast.
Up.
This is Sunset Boulevard. This is the tattoo parlor on Sunset Boulevard. The world famous, what's
Sunset
it called?
Strip.
Sunset.
Yeah.
And we're here. And we've been here before a few times. This one, as you can see, has been here quite a few times. And we're here again. And you may ask why we're here again. And
why are we here?
Why it's just too exciting. You don't want to imagine. If there was somebody asking this question, they'd ask us what we've been doing, and the answer is we've been recording an album and driving around in extremely borrowed cars, right? Not quite stolen, because you've got to have wheels in LA, you know, and you're so judged upon what you drive. All right, so the album's called Cocked and Loaded, and we're getting shit over that already. Like stores, department stores don't want a title like that. It's got this killer cover of this chick sitting on a gun.
The song's a killer, the production's killer. There ain't nobody gonna come out with an album that's gonna touch this album this year, so forget it. I'm about to get a new tattoo on my neck, and it's kind of the initiation for the Hollywood Vampire. You know, it's an LA Guns fan club. It's called the Hollywood Vampires, and the only way you can be in the club that you have two vampire bites right on your neck right here. You were the first guy to get them. My mom was the second person to get them, if you can believe that.
True.
So now I'm going to get them. I'm probably about to like 100,000th in line. This is Mike over here. He's cleaning my neck. The skin's got to be clean because God knows what's been on my neck lately. He shaves the hair off so it doesn't get, you know, caught in the needle. Because what it is, a tattoo is a bunch of needles that go real fast up and down with ink in them. Puncture the skin, and then you're scarred for life. That's the way it goes, man. By the way,
it
hurts.
You in years. So,
I know. That's what it sounds like. It's kind of like getting your teeth drilled. Oh, but there ain't no teeth.
Not that bad.
He's lying. Anybody can get a tattoo. Safe fun. They're doing the blood right now. And it'll look like my neck's bleeding for the next million years. We'll be out on the road soon. Believe me. You know, if you sat home all the time, we'd be covered with tattoos.
Okay, Tracii, you got it all done, bud.
All right.
You're all set.
Rock and roll, man.
Yeah. Hey, you guys got a new video out?
Mm-hmm.
Which I'm sure you'll want to tell us all about it.
It's called Electric Gypsy, and we shot it out in the desert in California, and it's pretty much all on motorcycles, not too much performance in it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just been out for a couple weeks now.
Now, what kind of motorcycles are these?
Like? All Harleys.
Uh-huh.
All Harleys.
You wouldn't go for anything else besides Harleys?
Mm, it's questionable.
Well, we would, but, you know.
No, we're a Harley band. Okay, yeah.
Now, you've had, was it two other videos so far?
Sex Action and One More Reason.
What are the main differences, do you think, between what we're about to see and the previous two?
Nudity, violence. The first one was really, we basically just did it for ourselves. It was like naked girls that kill us. And it was just supposed to be like fun. And it was.
Uh-huh.
It was fun. I get my head blown off and falls off a building. But nobody would play it, so we have it. My mom likes it, so. But these, the last two are a little bit like tamer, so you know, so somebody can see them.
Well, you're gonna stay with us for for at least for this hour, right?
I'm hanging, babe.
Okay, let's take a look at Electric Gypsy. Here's L.A. Guns. All right, Headbangers, Adam Curry here with Steve and Kelly of L.A. Guns, drummer and bass player.
Finally.
Yeah, we figured that one out.
Those guys don't know.
Don't tell them about that. Now, of course, you know, all metal is best to be seen live. And you've been on the road with... oh, come on, don't give me that. You've been on the road with some veteran bands.
AC/DC, and we did some dates with Iron Maiden.
Mm-hmm.
And Ted Nugent, and we're going out with Cheap Trick and Def Leppard.
And is there a lot to learn for a relatively young band when you're on the road with guys like this?
Yeah, well, you know,
they learn how to drink heavy. They're pros, so they know what they're doing. But we're willing to learn, so.
How about musically?
Nah.
No?
No, yeah, there's plenty to learn. I mean, they're so professional and everything, and
mm-hmm.
you know, their shows run like clockwork, so, you know, we learn a lot. The whole crew learns, everybody learns.
Are there things that you still want to perfect for your live shows?
Absolutely, yeah. You know, we're playing all the time. That's the best thing for us right now. That's where we're getting where we want to get. But that's the only thing that we could recommend is just keep playing all the time, you know?
Mm-hmm. So you said you're going out with Cheap Trick and...
Def Leppard. And then we're going to, like, wrap up this year with Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And that'll be 11 months on the road.
Really?
Yeah.
That's long enough for you?
I'm tired.
First of all, I want to thank you. I neglected to say that I was given this nice little present here. What is this officially called now?
The L.A. Guns Jewelry. I don't know.
You guys had these things specially made? And
our manager did. He had some of those just for promo.
Uh-huh.
He has clothing stores in L.A. on Melrose.
Uh-huh.
And all our like money came from like selling leather jackets and jewelry.
Oh, really?
To back the band.
But do you guys have like other stuff that you make up as well?
Tons.
Oh yeah, right.
Tons of stuff, man. Bring that truck.
Now, of course, there's you guys must get hassled all the time about, you know, questions about Guns N' Roses. And was it recently that there was some falling out between L.A. Guns and Guns N' Roses? I mean, I figured now you're here.
Yeah, we did. When they couldn't do the Iron Maiden tours anymore, they called us, and we were in Florida, and they asked us if we wanted to do it, so we said yes. So we flew the next day right out to L.A. and started like at Irvine Meadows, and we had all rented equipment because our stuff was being driven from Florida. So Flash and Izzy came out and played with us. And, you know, it was just all rented equipment and it just really sounded bad. So it's like, you know, they think we were like...
Well, the whole backline went down. You know, we lost power on stage and...
Yeah, we weren't like sabotaging them or anything. It's like, you know, it's...
So there's no bad blood. It was just
absolutely not.
Right. We all sounded like crap, you know. So it was crap cut.
So nothing was lost.
No,
right.
No, we don't think like that. I mean, we don't work like that. You know, we just wanted to play. It was great, like playing.
You stay around. We got some cool videos coming up for you.
Okay. And, I'm going to the bar that around the block, and I'll be back.
Okay. Well, I'll see you in a bit then. Right now, here's Guns N' Roses, "Sweet Child of Mine."
No, it's not that much difference, really. It's like the same sort of thing, clubs and, arenas and stadiums and stuff.
So you guys are working on your second album. When are we going to hear the second L.A. Guns album?
It's supposed to be July, and then it got put back to August.
So August.
Yeah. 91.
August 91.
Do you have any ideas what the titles are going to be?
Yes, we do.
It's going to be called Ricky Rockman.
Yeah.
I like that one.
Strikes Again.
Ricky.
Should we tell him?
Tell us.
It's called Cocked and Loaded.
Cocked and Loaded. That's good. We'll be back with more juicy gossip from L.A. Guns.
Welcome back to the Headbangers Ball on Jennifer tonight. We've got Philip and Tracii from L.A. Guns. So nice to see you guys again.
So nice to be here.
How you doing?
Good. What's up, homeboy?
Good. First of all, I want to tell you, Kelly Nichols, the bass player of L.A. Guns, was injured in a really bad motorcycle accident. I know this because I was riding with him that day. It happened about 4 years ago. And he recently, I guess, went back into the hospital.
Yeah, so he had a rod taken out of his leg when he broke it.
He had a pussy rod.
Was like,
he
had to pull it
so,
out.
So we've got an address to write to Kelly because when he was in the hospital a couple years ago, we sent him like all these like porno magazines, and he always loves that. So if you want to send that kind of stuff or get well cards or marriage proposals or anything, here's the address. It's Kelly Nichols, care of the Hollywood Vampires, which maybe we'll talk about that. 6255 Sunset Boulevard, number 917, Hollywood, California, 90028. Now, Kelly is in the hospital, and you guys are playing. What are you doing for bass player right now?
Mick's doing it.
Mick's playing bass. You remember, Mick used to be the bass player in the band before we got Kelly, so he's just filling in.
Rather than getting someone else in.
Yeah. So you guys are back to a four-piece
now? Four-piece right now, yeah.
Okay.
So we're doing a lot of stuff off the first album.
Okay, well, right now, let's take a look at the video. This is L.A. Guns, the one that's kind of been getting you right up the charts.
That's right. Here's if you haven't seen this video, you must be living under a stone.
Exactly. Somewhere. This is the Ballad of Jane.
The Salad of Jane.
You guys are playing some shows with the London Choir Boys, right?
A whole tour.
Uh-huh.
Like 6 weeks. As a matter of fact, it's fun.
Uh-huh. How's the show's been going?
It's great, you know, ever since the Salad of Jane video came out, you know, things have been pretty.
Because you're hearing that like on all the top 40 radio stations,
Kiss
and it's really just
you
which
believe
is a big
that.
Top 40 station in LA. Also, I guess Mick is filling in for somebody in the Choir Boys.
Oh well, just for a couple of shows. Chris, the keyboard player, had to go back to England, and they got him up to play some songs.
So you're keeping him pretty busy.
Well, yeah. It just seems like this whole year's been like every band, like members have been like, you know. Dropping out for a couple weeks and stuff. Like every band, it's really weird.
Mm-hmm. You never know who's going to play in which band.
Yeah.
Now, tell us about the new home video you come. Did you remember on the last home video, I played a bartender?
That's right.
For about 2 seconds.
Well, that's right. That was the one-way ticket, wasn't it?
I think so.
Yeah.
Well, tell us about the new one that you guys
go ahead.
Okay, so we got Rip and Tear, Never Enough, The Salad of Jane.
Malaria?
Malaria. We did
a
video for Malaria.
What's that going to be like?
It's kind of like, it's, you know, they're not going to release it as a single, so it's going to be...
Dirty?
Yeah, yeah. It's a gritty kind of clip, and it's lots of backstage, you know, goofing around with black and white, Super 8 stuff, and it's good. It really gets the character of the band across, and I Want to Be Your Man,
and it's
which
called,
we did on the stage.
Tell them what it's called. Let's talk a little bit about I Want to Be Your Man when we come back.
Right.
But right now, let's take a look at the result of last week's Headbangers Ball Busters. Now, remember, you got the choice to vote between Death Angel's Seemingly Endless Time and Dio's Wild One. Now, in a few minutes, the winner's going to take on. Okay, once again, Philip and Tracii from L.A. Guns. Now, we were talking a little bit about the videos, and we are going to see a video for I Want to Be Your Man, which is the next single.
Yeah, we wanted to bring it here today, but I guess it's not quite ready.
Not done.
But we will see it as soon as it's ready.
Right, exactly.
Definitely.
And, of course, you can see it in your home by buying the home video, which is called...
Love, Peace, and Geese.
Okay, now, explain? or shouldn't we explain?
No, exactly. It's not too much to explain. We didn't really want to do anything like tough because that would be pretentious and we didn't... I don't know, it just sounds good, doesn't
geese
it?
Geese aren't too pretentious.
Well, the thing is, you know, the big sex, booze, and tattoos, yeah, things that we've always done, everybody's ripping it off now. So we wanted to come out with something to fill in for sex, booze, and tattoos that just didn't mean
anything. That's right, put a bit of humor in it, too.
And let's see if, like, all the new bands that come out are now going to have all these things with geese on it.
Oh, but we
used the word geese before L.A. Guns did.
Yeah,
now,
exactly.
How much more touring do you guys have to do?
Two weeks.
And then what are you going to do?
Oh, we're not going to say. No.
You're not going to tell us what you're going to do, or?
Oh, well, you know, we got to do another record while this one's still hot so we can get it out there so we can keep the momentum going.
Have you started writing for it yet?
Yeah, kind of.
I think we've all started writing, but not collectively yet.
Is that when you guys do write music for the new record, does everybody kind of go off on their own
ideas? Every song's different. It comes together in a different way, you know. Sometimes we can sit in a studio with nothing and then we can create a song. Mm-hmm. Other times, either one of us or any of the band can come in with a completely finished
There's always too many songs.
So it's really collaborating.
Yeah.
Great. Well, I want to thank you guys for coming in. It was good to see you again.
Yeah,
and congratulations on the success.
It's doing good, huh?
Anyway, right now, it's time to vote for tonight's Headbangers Ball.
Where are you guys from originally, and where did the band L.A. Guns originate?
That's a hard one.
This is difficult.
I don't know.
Like, L.A., New York. Chicago.
The first two will do.
Okay.
I don't know.
How did the band, how did you guys come together as a band?
That's a long story, actually. I mean, it started happening, I guess.
Well, we were in the Pet Shop Boys.
Well, he was in the Pet Shop Boys.
There's too many guys in the band, so nobody was making any money, so we split up and... No, that ain't it.
I actually met him in New York.
Well, how did you name your band L.A. Guns?
Well, this
Tracii Guns.
Yeah, my
is that
Hollywood.
Your real name, yeah. Tracii Guns?
Well, it is now. This girlie I used to go out with, like when I was
Gunsenheimer.
17. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Gunsenstein. She just started calling me Mr. Guns all the time. And, a friend of mine was in a band called Hollywood Rose, so I figured, well, Hollywood, okay, I call my band L.A. You know, Guns, and his last name was Rose, my last name, so L.A. Guns.
I see. Are you from L.A.?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm the only guy in the band that's from L.A.
I see. What about this video that we're showing right now, Ballad of Jane?
Well, this I wrote like lyrics for one night watching Playboy Channel, which had a special about Jane Mansfield on.
Uh-huh.
And I just kind of turned off the music on the tape and actually on the TV and listened to the tape and just started writing about it. So you wrote the song? It did the best for us.
Yeah.
It was cool.
That was your hit, right?
Yeah, so far. Our biggest.
Now let's talk about the video that we're going to show. It's One More Reason.
To Die.
Yes, One More Reason to Die.
In L.A.
In L.A.
Right.
This very suicidal video.
No.
What? Who
we
wrote
We
this
lost
song?
Our first drummer in that video. If you see, like, at the end, he jumps off the building. That was...
Well, that chick knocked him off.
Yeah, that was actual footage of him falling off the building.
That's why we have...
You're right! Just kidding. I don't got
My him. Heart just stopped. Okay. I was like, oh, God.
No, but it was cool. It was fine. No, it was a dummy.
All right, so let's check out this video, One More Reason to Die.
Listen, Steve's going to tell you how to win. There's going to be a contest. Hot and Heavy L.A. Guns are going to give away the Fender Stratocaster.
Take two.
Phil.
So, anybody who sends in the best Polaroid of his girlfriend's tits, wins his guitar, and you know, so you can.
It doesn't have to be his girlfriend. It could be his mom or somebody he knows.
His little sister, something, or his, you know. And then you can like play this, and then you can,
you can be
famous, and then you can like just, you know, buy her a car, and she'll be cool.
Buy her a bra.
You know,
not necessarily the biggest, the best.
The best, the nicest, the roundest, firmest.
Hair-like.
It's not like just size. It's all the good things that make breasts what they are, and it means so much to us, you know. So send, you know, the good ones, man.
Any of them.
No pigs, you know. Nothing over
like... We need breasts.
Nothing over like 8 tons, you know. Like gross. And this is yours, man. So you win this and this marker, too. Oh, I don't remember.
The
best tits win.
We have the fabulous L.A. Guns.
When I go see a band live, or even if it's like a taping of a live show, I like to look at who I want to look like. I don't want to have to be forced to like look at everybody like all the time, like, you know, you have to like, you're going crazy, going just focusing on this guy. I want to see what he's doing. You know what I mean? I have a problem with that, you know, and some of our, all the videos between, like, our sex action video and, like, the Electric Gypsy video and this new video, I always thought was cool, but I had a problem with all the ones in between because they were all quick edit videos, and it's like, never focused on us, and I think we're pretty interesting looking, you know, we got tattoos and we got, you know, our hair is all dumb looking and stuff, you know, so it's like, that needs to be focused in on this band. And Guns N' Roses, you know, people are just like, you know, like, well, why did you leave that band? You know, why did you do this? Well, nobody ever knew they were going to sell 8 million records, man. You know what I mean? And the fact, you know, I actually knew those people. Those were my friends, and we had falling out, and, you know, things like that, that, you know, you just, you know, everybody's human. You know what I mean? And everything, you know, has its own twists and turns and stuff. But yeah, people are really interested in background, you know, and like what it was like to work with these people and how do you like working with the new people and stuff like that, you know. And for me personally, I mean, I'm going to be 24 next week. And it's like, you know, when I was playing in Guns N' Roses and stuff, I was like 19 years old. You know, I didn't know what I was going to do. You know, I mean, I just, I feel that like in the last 2 years, I really got a good hold and what I want to do musically, you know what I mean? It's kind of tough being, you know, being professional that young and, like, being expected all the time to, like, have the right answer, like, this is why I do this, you know? I don't know. The very first one I got was this little heart with a guitar on it. And if you notice, the guitar is left-handed, so I fucked up. And it just kind of grew. I got that, and when Randy Rhoads died, I got this blue rose. You know, when my cousin died, I got this purple rose over here, and then this girl bought me this my name for my birthday, and then all of a sudden, I woke up one day and went,
"Ow! It hurts."
Chicks, man, sign my tit. So you sign it, and like you see them 6 months later, and they've had it tattooed. They've had the autograph tattooed on breasts and legs and stuff. So that's kind of a weird thing to do.
That's pretty wild.
Would you do that if a chick brought in a?
It's been done. We've done it. I've tattooed everywhere.
Has somebody ever had their?
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. Tattooed a girl's lips one time. Wrote pull tab on the inside of each one.
Oh.
Pull tab, Jesus. Which lips were those?
Oh, they weren't the ones she was speaking of.
I was wasted last night. And
what was up?
It was like the night before. Well, they asked us to go jam at this club, the China Club. And when I got there, Entwistle's doing My Generation. So it's like, see ya. You know, I don't think I want to play today, man. You know? All the best like musicians in the world just looking at him and, you know, yeah, I'm going to go up there and, like, fuck up Honky Tonk Women, okay? I don't know. So I just got shit-faced and depressed and, you know.
You feeling better? I'm perking up.
It's, yeah, good, good. I'm glad to hear it. It seems like the closer to a bone, the more it hurts.
The best thing to do is get them where you want them because you're going to survive it anywhere.
Right.
You
know. There we go, right? We brought these little guys to life, you know, their faces and stuff. You know, considering it was done like in 1942, it's like it was about time that it was up to date.
Welcome back to the Headbangers Ball. It's a special, another on the road location edition of the ball. And right now we're in the studio with LA Guns, and here's Phil Lewis. Hello. I love LA Guns, and this is, like, I guess, a special corner of your rehearsal studio, right?
Yeah.
What do you call it?
We've come to create. This is the, I couldn't really say it on television, they'll ban it, but it's a nice little part of the studio, isn't it?
Yeah. I also noticed, before we go, I want to talk about the tour, the new video,
right,
everything else what you guys are doing, and also the new drummer.
Oh,
I was,
yes,
noticing the Alice in Wonderland book, because you hosted the Headbangers Ball a couple months ago.
That's
without
right.
Me.
You were sick, weren't you?
Something like
poor
that.
Poor thing. yeah, and I made this plea for anybody who had an old Alice in Wonderland book at home, and I got tons, so thank you very much. And I figured that was like the best, I mean, not that one's better than the other, but this was the best one. And yeah.
This was sent from a viewer?
Yeah, yeah.
Still going to read
No, I won't read anything. Now. Unfortunately, the person that sent it didn't sign it, but it's got absolutely fantastic illustrations. Like, much better than the John Tenniel ones, the regular ones. So yeah, it was really great. It was, you know, I was just goofing off, really. And I didn't expect the overwhelming response that we got, but I'm glad we did.
We'll be back talking to Phil, and we're going to hang out in the rehearsal studio, actually, for the whole show tonight. But right now, it's time for Skull Crusher number 5. Here is Kweensryche with Anybody Listening.
So, that guy's a karate expert.
Back on the Headbangers Ball, I'm Ricky Rackman here with Phil Lewis of LA Guns, and we're hanging out at a little secluded
cozy corner
of your rehearsal studio.
T will be here any minute.
So what have you guys been up to since the last time we spoke to you?
We did our first world tour that that started in Wyoming and ended up in London and Japan and all kinds of exotic places in between.
I hear LA Guns are huge in Japan.
Okay, you know, pretty good. It's always been real encouraging for us to go over there. We, you know, whenever we start touring an album, we go over there and test the waters with it. Yeah, they're great.
And you've played with huge bands. I mean, you go with Def Leppard,
right.
Iron Maiden.
Yeah. Yeah, we've been really
AC/DC.
Lucky. And we went out with AC/DC a couple of times, and that was really good. I mean, we'd grown so much from the first tour to the last tour that we just came off of in the summer.
Do you think that going out with such bands of such a big magnitude that you sometimes, there's things you can learn, especially like watching veterans like Def Leppard and AC/DC, are there certain things, do they ever give you tips or certain things, hey, we can use something like that?
I think we learned a lot off of Cheap Trick. They're a band that that have had all kinds of highs and lows, and you know, realistically a band that wants to be around for a while will experience that, and watching the way they dealt with it was very very cool. I like those people a lot.
Brilliant. Okay, we're gonna play a video from you right now. This is one that when I saw it, it kind of reminded me of the old like Beatles television appearances.
That was the idea. We've been sitting on the bus and watching a lot of Ed Sullivan shows when the Stones and the Beatles first came over.
Right.
And we thought, wouldn't it be neat? And we made our own little 60s TV program.
Great, well, let's take a look at it. Here's LA Guns with Never Enough.
Steve was unhappy in the band, and I think it's best that he moved on. He's a great guy and a great drummer, and we wish him all the best. But we felt that it was very difficult for us to carry on. And it's a shame because we've been together for a long time. So we didn't know what we were going to do as far as finding a replacement for him. Tracy remembered a showcase gig that he'd gone to a long time ago, 6 months, 8 months ago. And he remembered a drummer. He said he woke up one in the middle of the night and goes, oh, I saw this guy's face looking at me. I remembered he was exactly the right guy for us. And he came down and played, and he was great. We had to see other people as well, but it was pretty obvious that MC Bone was the guy for the band. Yeah. And his drumming's incredible, and I think that the band will definitely benefit for his.
Great. Well, we're going to meet him when the Headbangers Ball returns, but right now we're going to play the new latest video from you called It's Sober Now.
Sober Now.
Sober Now?
Sober Now.
Explain about the video a little bit.
Oh, I don't know. Sober Now. Well, you know, I don't know. Just watch the video.
Watch the video. Here's LA Guns with, as he said, Sober Now.
Sober Now.
Owner of the rehearsal studio of LA Guns. And Phil, why don't you introduce the newest addition to LA Guns?
The extraordinary person.
To the MTV viewers.
Mr. MC Bones, ladies and gentlemen.
What does the MC stand for?
Mighty Cool.
did you make that up yourself?
No, I didn't. Not at all. It's my name.
So MC's, what happened? Now, what happened? You found out they were auditioning, or Tracy called you?
Yeah, we got along really good when I first met him. And so we said we'd get together and maybe write a tune or something, you know, just mess around. And ended up being, somebody called me up, and Left Bank actually called me up and asked me to come down and audition. I was like, they said, are you interested? And I go, well, yeah.
Because did you play with any bands before?
Yeah, I'd played with several local Hollywood bands and stuff like that. And
this is your first time playing in a big band?
First big tour band, you bet.
And you're about to go on the road. Are you a little bit nervous?
I'm more nervous about just like not coming home. You know, I don't want to come home, man. The playing parts. Just,
What's the biggest crowd you've played for so far?
Probably about 1,800, something like that. But I haven't played any big shows yet with the guys. You know,
right. We've done a couple of shows. We did one for Gibson down at the NAMM thing, and then we did like a little surprise benefit as the Vampires in Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
All pretty low key stuff, but he played great. You know,
it's going to be pretty cool. Then just go out on the road.
Yeah. It's out of hand, really.
Great.
Out of hand.
Okay, well, we'll be back as Headbangers Ball continues from LA Guns rehearsal studio. But right now, here is Metallica with Nothing Else Matters. Joined with Bill Lewis and MC Bones, the new drummer of LA Guns. And we spoke a little bit about the tour that's going to kick off very shortly.
I wish you could have been in Europe, actually, you know, when we were over there with the skids. It was.
He didn't invite us.
So. Yeah. No, him.
A monster show, man.
Yeah, that would have been great, but...
Yeah, how big was that?
Well, we played some really big shows over there with them at first, and then when they went back, we went and did some of our own in smaller places. It was amazing. Amazing going back, because it was the first time I'd ever played in England with LA Guns.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So
because you used to be in, I don't know how many people know, but you were in a band called Girl.
Yeah, I was in tons of bands over in London. You know, it's like it was like where I grew up. And so I was real nervous and excited about going back. And
so that was the first time for you really playing a hometown show.
Yeah, it worked out really amazingly well. And a lot of good memories.
Now the tour that's about to start kicks off when and where?
Ventura Theater on the 28th, which is like my new local gig.
But are you going to be going all across America with us?
Yeah, up the West Coast, across the Canadian tundra.
Yeah,
and
bring warm clothes.
Back to England in April, and we're doing South America. But none of your Rock in Rio stuff. I'm talking like sort of 2,000-seater
clubs
and stuff. Yeah, like
because a lot of bands don't get over there to play the smaller clubs.
Well, apparently there's a new market opening up now. You know, like all the fascist regimes have broken down, so they're like.
They're ready to be exposed.
Yeah. Exploited.
So you're going to get to hit the world. This will be good for you, right?
Yeah.
Get to do a lot of traveling.
Yeah, definitely. It's can't wait. You know, it's a big opportunity.
He'll be crying for his mom.
Three days.
I want my mommy.
Well, the Headbangers Ball will be back at the rehearsal studio with LA Guns. But right now it's time for Skull Crusher number 3. Here is the great Soundgarden with Outshine. Welcome back to the Headbangers Ball right now. Not only is Mick here, but Tracii Guns is joining us, and I'd like to comment a little bit on this since you guys started back in the early part of the 80s, mid-80s, and the LA scene at that time, like in 86, was just really, really starting. I mean, a lot of bands were getting signed.
We were really young,
and become who we all were. but a lot of bands, you know, went on to big stuff.
Yeah.
And now it seems like...
We're still waiting.
And now it seems like a lot of the scene... Huh?
What?
You're waiting for your turn to get the big stuff?
Yeah, we want to be big, man.
Like...
Help us out, like Guns N' Roses, man. We want to be big.
But about the LA scene,
like Nirvana.
Just like, but they're not from LA. Because now the thing is,
big.
You have to be from Seattle. You see, that's how it works.
Bones is from Seattle.
Now I figured out why he got in the band. Because it's to have that
it's
Seattle
trendy.
Thing. Because they have the Seattle
it's
thing.
It's trendy.
But I'm wondering, you know, what do you guys think of the LA scene now? I mean, it's obviously changed in the past 6 years.
Not really.
You don't think it's changed?
Not much.
Still
lots
how much?
Of rock and roll bands. Still lots of...
But don't you think that a lot of bands out there now... This is my opinion. It seems like in 1986, a lot of the bands were kind of fresh and nobody was trying to be
Now
it seems like everybody's trying to be either LA Guns or Guns N' Roses or Faster or whatever.
Is it's like this 4 or 5 year cycle. Like every 4 or 5 years, somebody will come out doing something totally cool and different. And it'll be like 3 or 4 bands. For some reason that do that are really cool and different, and they make it, then everybody copies them for 4 or 5 years until somebody comes up with something new or whatever is happening, you know, they make it happen. And there really hasn't been anything in LA that I've gone, BB Chunk King's pretty happening,
mm-hmm.
No, but that's real bluesy kind of stuff, but there's, you know, there really isn't, it's just, you know, I don't really get off on the scene as much as I used to, because it doesn't really seem like, you know, ever since James Addiction split and
bands, like, that was really, like, those were, like, the bands that we all used to check out and stuff.
We took, like, a few of them on tour with us, like, Celebrity Skin.
Yeah, Celebrity Skin.
But they broke up. All the good bands seem to break up these days. You know, they get to the first step and they go away. It's a shame.
Okay. We'll be back talking to the guys in LA Guns, but right now it's time for Triple Thrash Threat. Included in tonight's Triple Thrash Threat is Deliverance with Weapons of Our Warfare. But right now, here is Death Angel. Now, there's a lot of Death Angel fans, myself included. Obviously, Tracii loves Death Angels. He hit my watch. And they will be
nice
coming
watch,
out with
Ricky
new stuff very shortly under the name The Organization. Here is Death Angel with Seemingly Endless Time. To the ball, now joining us on the couch is Kelly Nichols, bass player of LA Guns with Tracii Guns. And
couch potato.
Just curious, how is your leg? Because I know...
My leg is good.
It's been a long time, but you still had problems with it?
Yeah, I keep messing it up, but it's good now.
You're getting excited to get back out on the road?
Yeah. I gotta get out, man.
Now, we talked very briefly about the tour with the other guys. You're headlining this tour, right?
Yeah, big club tour.
Which is pretty cool.
That's great.
And you excited to get out and play again?
Yeah. Now, hey,
Kristen. You know, you're always playing. I mean, when you're not doing LA Guns, you did Contraband. You have another pig. Oh,
pig.
I remember the pig show.
Singer of Pig,
that was
right
very,
here.
Very classic show, one that a lot
two
of people
shows.
Try to forget. My two only shows.
Arizona and LA Cat House.
Exactly. And you've
Killing
got
Machine.
Another project that you're having fun with right now called Killing Machine. Is it you just like to, like, when you're not doing stuff with LA Guns, you just always want to be playing?
Yeah. Well, actually, I mean, since we got Bones in the band, I'm, like, super, like, really, like, weird about LA Guns now. Like, it's like, I really don't want to do anything else anymore. LA Guns to me is just like the ultimate band now. It's like he was the link. That
what type of things does he add to the band?
Energy, just like young, raw, sick energy that's really cool. I mean, the band is like really
young,
energy.
Energetic.
Now, when does this tour end, Kelly?
When does it end?
Yeah. Is there a time?
It never ends, man.
It never ends. I mean, is there any plans about starting work on another LA Guns record soon?
It never ends, man.
The never ending
it
tour,
never
man.
Ends. I think probably by the end of the year, I guess, we'll start something, or, you know, after the Christmas holidays.
Yeah. Well, right now, let's play Skull Crusher number 2. You can tell us what it is, Tracii, since you know so well.
It's
from
LA.
Seattle. Wow! Pearl Jam! Alive! Did you see me look at the cue card? That was cool.
Kelly Nichols, I just want to change the subject a little bit. What
Hi,
possessed
Brandy.
You, even though it's been about 7 months since you have, what possessed you to cut your hair?
Satan.
How long have you been?
7 months?
2.5 years.
Since your hair was short?
Cut it the day before we did the Ballad of Jane video.
That wasn't that long ago.
Yeah.
I guess it was. Like I said, 2.5 years.
It's grown.
Well, I never asked you this question before.
That's true.
And have you noticed that a lot of
nope.
other bands are cutting their hair short now?
I know. So I think it's time to, like, I'm going to get, like, a no-hawk, like, right down the middle. And, like look like, what's his name, Larry on the Three Stooges.
Big shave thing down the middle
yeah.
of the hair.
And, like, I'll just dye, like, the skin part. Like, but this is, you know, nah, maybe not.
Now, when you
Tommy
work...
Tommy Lee looks cool with short hair, huh?
Yeah. When you work on a new album, do you write a lot on the road, or is that...
Well, it's funny, because, like, for some reason, when we did, after our first...
Get it?
when we toured for the first album, we wrote Cocked and Loaded on the road. We wrote our second album on the road, but when we toured for Cocked and Loaded, we didn't write anything. So when we had to do Hollywood Vampires, we were like stuck in a studio for like 4 or 5 months. It's like losing our minds, you know?
What's the best environment to write in? Is there a, quote, good environment
I think,
to write
I
in?
Tropicana.
Yeah, something like that. But I think for us, I think that the way that it works the best is Phil writes his tunes, I'll put my stuff together, Kelly, Will, Mick, and everybody. They do their stuff at home, and we get in the studio, and we all just like yell at each other and say, I want to do my songs, no, I want to do my songs, and then over a period of time, they all end up getting done, and then we pick them. So,
we end up doing Tracii songs.
Yeah, and we end up doing Tracii songs.
Oh,
who's
I
Tracii?
See. That works.
So, but we've already started writing. So we're gonna have a little bit of a head start this time. So, I mean, it was like almost 2 years between albums with Cocked and Loaded and Hollywood Vampires, like 18 months or something.
But this one's been out a while, and there's our still, you know, a brand new
it's started,
video on MTV.
Yeah,
so
that'll be a while, I know.
Well, right now let's play something a little bit older from LA Guns. Here is Electric Gypsy.
A little older, a little younger.
Welcome back to the Headbangers Ball here with Phil Lewis and Tracii Guns.
And Ricky Rackman.
From L.A. Guns.
And Cat House.
Oh, there you go.
And Headbangers Ball.
So,
Radio Cat
one
House.
Thing I noticed, that whenever I used to see you around the clubs or on TV and in the videos, I always had a few more tattoos than you do. And now I've got like hours to catch up with you.
You have hours
you've
to
got
catch
tons
up
of,
with me.
You've got tons of tattoos.
I have a lot of tattoos. I got this is
the chest, I found, is one of the most painful places to get tattooed. I didn't even get it finished.
See, that looks like, you know, it hurt.
People are liking that. Are you going to be getting any more tattoos soon? Or?
Maybe.
Big,
I don't
giant
know.
Tattoo.
I don't know. It's,
hey. How about Bones, your new drummer? Do you have very much ink?
Yeah,
he's got one tattoo, but he's ready to go under the gun for, you know, a good 80 hours. He wants double sleeves, chest panels, leg panels, right. Back panels, forehead. He wants to get acid-free tattooed on his.
Now, you're about to go on the road for...
7 weeks.
As Kelly said, the never-ending tour.
Yeah, I mean, it's never-ending.
Never-ending tour, 7 weeks.
Thing. Well, I mean, the next part we're doing Canada, and then we're going to go to England to do some headlining shows over there. And then we're going to go to South America, and we're going to do the States in the summer.
Israel, mm-hmm. Beirut, Belfast.
All the places.
All the hot
they
spots.
Love
we had, we had this thing. We had this press release for Cock and Love that said we were going to...
Africa,
like yeah, Africa and stuff, and like in this present, so everybody would ask us, so are you guys like really going to Africa? And we'd have to be like, well, I guess that's what it says. And we never went to Africa. Yeah, it's like
right. See, but there's all those African like gun fans that are
I'm sure
quite upset
are.
Now that thought that they're gonna see you guys.
And yeah, they wanted to hear No Mercy,
know.
Man.
Well,
know.
Thanks for taking the time to talk to us. Check out LA Guns when they hit
Hi,
your
Paula.
Town, and thank you for spending
Hi,
the time to talk to us.
Ladies and gentlemen. Tonight we have the fabulous L.A. Guns.
L.A. Guns were typical of the Sunset Strip bands of the late 80s. Loud, brash, and part of L.A.'s metal scene. Formed by original Guns N' Roses guitarist Tracii Guns and W.A.S.P. drummer Steve Riley, the band went gold with their second album, Cocked and Loaded. The record featured the top 40 hit, Ballad of Jane. Now it's all- LA Guns toured constantly. For the group, life offstage was just as wild as onstage.
Women everywhere, you know, just polishing your toenails. There are no rules. And you feel invincible. And as long as you don't end up in jail, you know, then you're getting away with it. And that's what it is. You're almost a criminal at that point, you know. I mean, you're just getting away with stuff that's unbelievable.
In 1991, LA Guns released Hollywood Vampires, the band's second gold record. Despite their success, they were under pressure to lighten up their tough guy image.
Everybody's trying to make us like these other bands. We were so happy just being ourselves. Even though those bands were doing so well, they were goofy, man. And we're friends with all of them. And to us back then, it was goofy because they weren't being themselves, you know? Hey. But, you know, these guys didn't want to put on these monkey uniforms and go on MTV. We never had to put monkey suits on.
LA Guns released three more albums, but by 1992, their popularity had peaked.
Nirvana came out, and things just changed. Fashion changed, everybody was cutting their hair, getting baggy potato sacks. And everything just changed. It just felt like, you know, it was a good run, it was time to move on.
After nearly a decade together, LA Guns called it quits. So where are they now?
It was pretty bad. I was lost. Just no idea what to do. Going to apply for a job was like just the most humiliating, you know, because it's you're mobbed. We've been mobbed. And then you're invisible. And then you gotta like, you know, get a job.
For bass player Kelly Nichols, finding a new job wasn't easy.
I got into computer graphics. My brother's a graphic artist.
But tell about excuse me, interrupt.
Sorry.
You know, he went up to Seattle and he applied for a job at Tower Records, and they wouldn't even give him a job at Tower Records. That's how pathetic that we couldn't even stop.
Holy thanks for bringing that one up, man.
Lead singer Phil Lewis continued to wow audiences. only this time his fans were slightly younger.
I dressed up as Batman and performed at children's parties. Paint their faces, kick them up the ass when mum wasn't watching, and it was boys, 10-year-old boys and stuff. It was nothing to it. You know, I was a good Batman. So it was no big deal. God, the tragedy and the pain. I can't do that. I'm a star. I think that's such a load of old bollocks. I really do. I think we were really lucky to get where we were, and we shouldn't like think ourselves unlucky because we're not there anymore.
Phil moved on to a career in television as an audio engineer for Fox.
You get paid for it. I have much more money now than I ever had when I was a musician.
As for guitarist Mick Cripps,
I went to work for a record company, a record label called Cleopatra, where I'm an art director. And
joined the opposition.
Yeah, I went over to the other side.
Founding members Tracii Guns and drummer Steve Riley continued to work together. In fact, shortly after the band broke up, they reformed the Guns with new members.
I've recorded an album every year since, and done like a world tour ever since.
Yeah,
every year since also, you know?
Yeah, we've been kind of like the Lakers, you know? It's like, you know, we keep getting like new players and everything like that. You know, trying to make the team better.
The duo have no plans of ever retiring.
Even if all the fans go away.
Yeah,
man,
we'll still be there.
You know, people say, well, there's nobody left coming to the shows, and we'll quit. Well, we won't.
The basic metal food groups are beer, Jack Daniels, and TNA. But LA Guns founder Tracii Guns put a new nauseating spin on metal cuisine when he pulled his pants down, sat on a salad backstage, then watched unknowing fans eat it up.
Mmm, what is this? Asparagus?
I love Tracii and I know Tracii and I love him so much, but that's horrible.
That's not right.
He did tend to pull his pants down a lot. He did it on stage while we were playing, and that's why it could have happened in the dressing room too.
Tracii has a habit of pulling his pants
down. He does,
down.
and pulling on his thing. He does. One time I was playing in this other band and they were opening up for us and he was doing that. Like, he thought I would be shocked, but I wasn't. I was just horrified. And I love him though, he is sweet.
Maybe it serves the fans right for thinking it's safe to eat anything backstage at a metal show.
I think I'd leave the catering alone. Yeah.